I was to start this series by talking about the global condition, state of the world, but given the situation in the Middle East, Susan asked me to address those issues. I thought she was a friend of mine. I asked her, how many hours can you give me? Okay. Well, you know the state of the Middle East, so hold on to your seats, it's going to be a rough ride. The Middle East. There are three things to note about the Middle East right now. The first is, it is collapsing. A political earthquake that started about 10 years ago is continuing with enormous convulsions. No other part of the world is so disturbed. There are two levels of disturbance. The international level, no big powers are looking around. Russia is snooping around. China is looking for opportunities. But the biggest international involvement is the American footprint. In 10 years, this country has gone into every part of the Middle East, spent enormous amounts of money. The Iraq war alone cost us 5 million lives, 32,000 wounded, and $1 trillion. We have today troops and bases all over the Middle East. Okay. And now we are once again at war with ISIS, which war takes us into both Iraq and Syria. Okay. The local dangers are intense. In the past 10 years, there have been a huge outburst of terrorism, the rise of terrorist organizations like Al-Qaeda, ISIS, and others. Okay. There have been all sorts of local disturbances, the rise and fall of the Arab Spring, wars between Shias and Sunnis, Iran and the nuclear issue, civil wars in Iraq, Turkey, Yemen, Libya, Bahrain, Syria. Okay. Lebanon has been without a government for months. Humanitarian issues are terrible. In the past 10 years, somewhere between 500,000 and 700,000 have been killed in violent action in the Middle East. Okay. Refugees, sicknesses, food shortages. Brutal private armies like Hezbollah, Hamas, Iraqi groups, Syrian dissidents march across the landscape. There are rich but very scared monarchies like Saudi Arabia and the Gulf principalities. Iran is torn in tension between theocrats and reformers. Turkey is drifting towards authoritarianism. Israel has been involved in three wars in Gaza in the past 6-7 years, and that's only a partial list. Okay. Some of these concerns affect America very seriously. Okay. And we are more involved than ever before. From the Persian Gulf to the Mediterranean, this is a snake pit. And outsiders who get into snake pits get badly bitten. The first thing to remember, the collapsing state of the Middle East. The second thing is this. Sectarian divisions are more violent than ever before. Sunni, Shia, all sorts of minorities, Kurds, Christians, Copts, Turkmen, Alawites, a variety of tribes are arming themselves. If they're not fighting, they're getting ready for war. It seems that it is quite easy to get unlimited amounts of deadly weapons and no shortage of cash for guns. War itself is changing. Drones, cyber war is coming to the Middle East. The third thing is this. Money continues to pour in and out of the Middle East. Large amounts of oil and natural gas, of course, waft back and forth. Three of the most strategic waterways in the world, Suez, Bosphorus, and the Persian Gulf, have remained open. If any one of them is blocked or closed, it'll have an enormous impact on the global economy. Because 90% of global commerce goes by sea, 65% of all oil trade goes by sea. Okay. The global economy is enormously vulnerable to events in the Middle East. Sanctions on Russian oil have put a premium on Middle East oil. So this is a terrible decade. All three things are interacting at the same time, the violence and political confusion, the sectarian hatreds, and the economic issues. Okay. And they are growing worse. The level of tension in the Middle East is higher than it has been for maybe 30 years or so. Any small miscalculation, any untoward event, can set off a major international war, which is why one has to be very careful in dealing with the Middle East. So how do you discuss this? Okay. How many hours can you give me? Okay. From this smoking cauldron, let me extract four broad themes and trends to define the snake pit and then get to something more specific. These trends will give you some general idea of the nature of those societies. The first thing to remember is this: the change in the population. About 400 million people live in the Middle East, that is North Africa and the areas that we think of the Middle East as more proper in what is technically called West Asia, that is from Israel to the Persian Gulf. Okay. 45% of those people are below 25 years of age. They are the drivers and shapers of events in the future. There is a big change in their literacy. In 1980, only half the Arabs could read and write. Today, 85% of young people between 15 and 24 can read and write, and all are connected with mobile telephones and the social media. About 3 years ago, the old worn-out regimes of the one-man dictators were exhausted and the reaction came. Late in 2011, young people all over the Middle East rose up against these old regimes. They rose up with democratic orientation. They were mostly educated. They did not believe in very much in violence. That was the Arab Spring. They succeeded. They upset the old regimes. They failed because some old regimes fought back. And two of the best organized forces captured the Arab Spring from young people. Those were the religious extremists, who are not only extreme but also anti-Western, and the military, who are generally more secular but just as brutal. Okay. And they have begun to fight each other. They are the inheritors of the Arab Spring. However, there are three youth narratives that are emerging. The first is, what happened to all those democracy-oriented youth who lost out? Are they there? Will they assert themselves again? Many of them are unhappy with both the military and the religious groups. Okay, they are quiet, but one can assume that somewhere along the way they'll assert themselves. The second youth narrative is that many of them have been broken and co-opted by the military. The military, young people, led by generals today of about 40 or 50 years old, very nationalist in their view. And a third group is being sucked in by the extremists, who are attracting young men and a few young women. Women have been the biggest losers in the collapse of the Arab Spring. Now, could we expect at some time another Arab Spring? May well be, because young people have tasted something and they're likely to ask for it again. But right now, across the Middle East, these two groups, religious extremists and the military, push and fight. We have not quite understood why young people are drawn to religious extremism. Do religious extremists offer them something that magnetizes them? Are these young people convinced that the religious vision of society is better than what they have? Why are they prepared to join and go to very often a certain death? There are today 10,000 young Islamic people who have gone to join the fights in Syria on all sides against Assad. 2,000 of them from Western countries are associated in one way or the other with ISIS, okay, including 200 or 300 from the United States. Do these religionists, these jihadists, offer a belief system? It's not money which makes suicide bombers or terrorists. And they are fearless, ready to die. When President Obama says, you have time to get out of the way, you might be killed, it means nothing. Okay. Now, can that flow of youth be moved away from jihadism to moderation? I don't know, but bombing them is not going to do it. Okay. And we have to examine the appeal of these forces to young people in greater depth. So the first thing to remember is the orientation of youth in the Middle East. The snake pit is defined also by the rise of organized religious groups. Since the Arab Spring, about 50 to 60 significant politically, religiously oriented groups have arisen in the Middle East. Many of them promote violence and terror, fear, generally anti-West. Okay. Some are small and very brutal, like ISIS, Al-Qaeda, a new group called Khorasan, Syrian opposition groups, Taliban in Afghanistan on the fringe. Okay. And some of these groups have spread into northern part of Africa, like Boko Haram, which captured those girls in Nigeria. Incidentally, they have been captured and held in captivity for over 100 days and still not released, most of them. Okay. They are well organized. The United States has been hunting some of these leaders for quite some time. But there's another type of religious group that has arisen, a broader-based group, like Hamas, Hezbollah, okay, parts of the Muslim Brotherhood, okay, who Iranian groups, who don't like the smaller groups, but are themselves fearsome adversaries. This rise of organized religious groups has been extraordinary in the context of the modern world. Okay. Now, cross-cutting all of these is another conflict that is ripping these groups apart, Sunni and Shia. Sunnis account for about 75% of Islamic believers in the world. Shia is about 20%. Okay. And a new sectarianism has brought them into conflict with each other. Al-Qaeda is Sunni, Hezbollah is Sunni. Hezbollah is Shia. Iranians are Shia. Hamas is Sunni. ISIS is Sunni. Okay. And they spent a lot of time fighting each other. Since 1979, the Shias have become notably energized because that was when the Ayatollah in Iran took power and began promoting Shiaism. A third feature of the Middle East is that right now there's a big leadership struggle taking place between four nations: a democracy, a theocracy, a military government, and a monarchy, each seeking to get more influence, to become more powerful in the Middle East. The democracy is Turkey, 75 million people, member of NATO, but not especially pro-American, once a good friend of Israel, not any longer, looking for advantages to get an increased position in the Middle East. But they're not Arabs, so they have a certain problem. They once ruled the Middle East as the Ottoman Empire. Okay. So that's one group. Another group is also non-Arab. That's, of course, Iran, 75 million people again, with their nuclear ambitions, developing now something that nobody discusses, a very formidable cyber technology. Okay. Increasing influence. Okay. They would like to have more power in the Middle East. They're also not Arab. And then there are the two Arab contenders. Egypt, now under military rule, the largest state in the Middle East with 85 million people. Sunnis, okay. With America, some of the time, not always, okay. And once again, getting back into their old military groove of governance. Okay. And then, of course, Saudi Arabia, who wants the United States to do all its dirty work, like finishing Assad off and bombing ISIS, 30 million people, but much larger because they have a number of associated states in the principalities that follow them, okay. Sunnis, but with their own code of religious conduct. Each of these countries is undergoing a major transition. Turkey is drifting into authoritarianism, and the question is this: will the Turkish leader Erdogan become more Islamist the more power he gets? Egypt. The military have ended a two-year experiment with democracy in Egypt and pushed the Muslim Brotherhood out. They've gone back to a 60-year track record of military government. Question: times are different. Will the frustrated young people tolerate this, and for how long? Iran. Last year, the reformers scored a major breakthrough by electing a president, but the Ayatollah still rules. Okay. The reformers are slowly trying to change things. Question: will the challenge to theocracy succeed? Okay. Saudi Arabia. How long can an obsolete royalist government continue in today's age? The answers to these four questions will determine much of the fate of the Middle East in the future. And each of them is now in process. Finally, there are the actual battlefield states. Most of the Middle East is a battlefield: Yemen, Kurdish areas, Libya, Algeria, so on. But I want to focus on two particular areas, Syria and Iraq. Syria has been in torment for 3 years. It's a small country, 22 million people. One third of those people have been killed or displaced in the past 3 years. There are 3 million refugees who've fled the country to Lebanon or Turkey or Jordan. 5 million are displaced within the country. Over 200,000 have been killed, and large numbers are missing. We don't know what has happened to them. Okay. Syria is three overlapping conflicts. And we made a very wrong assessment of Syria 3 years ago. We thought Assad would collapse, that he would vanish. Okay. And our government kept saying, you know, Assad must go, he must go, he'll go. Well, he's still there. Okay. There are three overlapping wars all taking place at the same time. There is first a civil war, many people against Assad, who with his father has run that country for 43 years. But he's supported by a community called the Alawites, 15-20%, and a few others. Okay. That's a local civil war against a dictatorship. There is a regional war for influence in Syria. Shias for Assad, Hezbollah for Assad, Iran for Assad, Iraq for Assad. Sunnis against him, Turkey, the Saudis, Jordan, Qatar against him, each with their own angle, trying to push their own advantage. And then there is an underlying international war: the United States and Western Europe against Assad, Russia with Assad, and possibly some assistance from China. One of the confusions is that part of those groups against Assad cluster around ISIS, okay, which has quite rapidly established itself as a big part of the Syrian opposition. There are others. Al-Qaeda is against Assad. Okay. Nusayra is against Assad. About 75 small groups are against Assad. Okay. And there are some which we think are more favorable towards us, called the Free Syrian Army. The situation in Syria is an endless conflict. Assad controls about 35%, including the capital, Damascus. Various opponents control about 40%, including the second largest city, Aleppo. ISIS controls about 15%, 20% of the country, and the rest is no man's land. Okay. So that conflict is going on with arms pouring in from all sides. And then there is Iraq. We invaded in 2003, a country which has a big Shia majority, 60% of the population, but was run by Saddam Hussein and his Sunnis for a long time. That society in 10 years has been brutalized. Unhappy with the way it was going, we produced a leader called Malaki in 2006. He was there for 8 years, and we've just managed to get rid of him. our selection of leaders does not qualify us for a prize. Okay? And that includes Karzai in Afghanistan. Okay? Now we are searching for another government, and we've got somebody called Abadi in the hope that he'll form a government. And ISIS has taken about 25-30% of Iraq, mainly in the Sunni areas, because the government of Shias, which we empowered, has brutalized the Sunnis in revenge for Saddam Hussein's time. These two conflicts are being joined together now because ISIS controls some land in Syria on the border and some land in Iraq on the border. This is the snake pit. The Russians are looking for some advantage. The Chinese are looking for trade. We are up to our neck in the snake pit. Okay. What has made this more complex? It is the rise of ISIS. 10 years ago, Al-Qaeda had a branch in Iraq. Its main base was Afghanistan. This branch consisted of local Iraqis who had allegiance to Osama bin Laden. They were strong in the Sunni areas of Iraq. And when we got rid of Sunni government of Saddam Hussein, they began taking arms against us. They've been fighting America and American-backed Shia governments for about 10 years now. We try to destroy them. Sometimes we succeed a little bit, but they're still there. One group of this Al-Qaeda in Iraq thought that Al-Qaeda was too kind an organization, not tough enough. And so a small group led by a man called Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi broke away from Al-Qaeda and formed ISIS. Baghdadi is 43 years old. He's an educated man. His degree is from University of Baghdad. He was imprisoned by the United States for 4 years in the early part of this decade. Okay. And his breaking away from Al-Qaeda is that they view that they really are softies. Okay. Al-Qaeda says they're too brutal, so there's a division there. But ISIS is now largely an Iraq organization that has spread into Syria. As American troops were getting out of Iraq, the Maliki government kept beating up the Sunnis, was corrupt and ineffective, and ISIS began to grow with Sunni support. Many of Saddam Hussein's former generals and officials have joined ISIS. Okay. ISIS has grabbed territory in Syria as well. It now controls an area of about 10 million people. It's carving out a new state from both Syria and Iraq. And on the 29th of June this year, the leader, al-Baghdadi, announced a caliphate. This is the new center of Islam, and he will be the caliph, the leader of Islam. That, of course, upset many other Islamic groups around the world. Okay. They've set up a government which is based on very rigid Salafi Islamic principles. They take few prisoners, but behead a lot. Women are under extraordinary restrictions with very conscribed social rules. They've been able to capture the second largest city in Iraq called Mosul in the north with some oil installations. They've come within 30-35 miles of Baghdad. Okay. They pushed into the Kurdish areas, and the Kurds have resisted them. Okay. And some of the Shia militias, tough guys in the Baghdad area, have been able to stop them there. So they've set up something like a government. Their government consists of 20 provinces, each with a local governor. Okay. The people whom they govern, most of them seem to dislike ISIS, but there are some who seem to like them. Okay. They have an army of about 12,000 in Iraq and about 20,000 in Syria, which is well-financed and well-paid, okay, and fights the Syrian government and the Iraqi government. Okay. They are, relatively speaking, quite rich. Capturing Mosul, they got a lot of money from government banks in Mosul. They ransom people. They are controlling 14 oil wells in Iraq and Syria, and they smuggle out some of that oil. It is estimated that they have about $1 billion in cash, and their income is about $2 million a day. And they have a large supply of weapons, most of which are our weapons, which the Iraqi government, the Iraqi army dropped and when they ran away. Okay. ISIS has been greatly helped by the confusion in Iraq with the Maliki government collapsing. Our Secretary of State spends much of his time running back and forth, trying to put together a government in Iraq. It's not a very rewarding enterprise. Okay. And now we've got another person called Abadi, whom we are trying to get organized a government, but he's having great difficulty in finding a cabinet. Okay. Now, ISIS makes a great deal of money on ransoms, some of which we know nothing about. People pay, they don't talk about it, particularly European governments. Okay. Two American journalists were captured and beheaded, and one from Britain also was beheaded recently because Britain and America refused to pay ransom. Our reaction was outrage, and we have done four things. The first is, on September 10th, 2 weeks ago, Obama declared war on ISIS and said we will destroy ISIS by heavy bombing in Iraq of its Iraqian segment. We have tremendous bombing activity from aircraft carriers in the Mediterranean and the Persian Gulf, from planes. We say it's pinpoint bombing, but you know, I doubt whether there's any such thing as pinpoint bombing. Okay. Second, we tried to firm up the Iraqis. We now have 1,600 troops there. We say no boots on the ground, but we're trying to put their army together. We have armed the Kurds in the Iraqi areas. Third, we are trying to put together an international coalition of Western states and some local states. Okay. Fourth, we have begun bombing in Syria. Okay. And also, at the same time, we are planning to train 5,000 Syrian opponents of Assad, give them arms, and let them loose against ISIS and against Assad. Okay. In this process, we have some unofficial local allies. Al-Qaeda is on our side. Hezbollah is on our side. Iran is on our side. Nice friends to have. Okay. This is the gateway to another big war, which will cost us billions and many, many lives. We are hoping that the Iraqis will put together their army, that their militias will be able to fight ISIS, that the Kurds will be able to do so, that maybe some other Arabs will put boots on the ground, but so far the results are not very good. And our leadership tells us it will take years to work this out. Now, what are we to do about this? Anyone who gets into this kind of a situation in the Middle East has three choices. We can get in big, which we say we don't want to do. We can get in small, which we are doing, but small becomes big. Or we can stay out. Right now, we are so hugely involved in the Middle East that it'll take me half an hour to give you a list of our bases, our special forces, the arms we are supplying, the secret groups that are working for us, the activities that are going on. My own view is somewhat controversial on this, and many people don't agree with me. I believe that given our improving energy situation, we have no need to get over-involved in the Middle East. Let it burn itself out. Let local people deal with their local problems. We should protect our borders and defend ourselves at home, subject to two things. Subject to the export of terrorism and jihadism to America and the security of Israel. Those are the two things which we should be concerned about in the Middle East, and let other fires burn themselves out. That is my view, which is not very popular today. Let me deal with them separately. Concern about the export of jihadism to the United States. We are absolutely right to be concerned about this, especially the barbaric actions against Americans by ISIS. and they should be punished for their atrocities. But I want you to remember two things as we say this. One, we could probably have saved those two American lives if we negotiated and paid ransom. We don't. Britain doesn't. But others do. France does. Turkey does. Germany maybe, we don't know. Israel certainly does. They exchange 1,027 troops, prisoners for Galil Shalit a couple of years ago. So, should we pay ransom or not? I don't know. We have taken the position that we don't. Second, we are truly and correctly horrified at the beheadings, two Americans, threats against others. But remember this, our ally Saudi Arabia beheads people regularly. In August, in 18 days, they beheaded 22 people. Last year, Saudi Arabia beheaded 79 people for smuggling, for sorcery, whatever that means, for sexual issues. What are we doing about that? Human rights. Saudi Arabia forbids any non-Islamic religious practice. So we have these questions to consider as well. Okay. Is it that we are against beheading when it's done by someone we don't like? Okay. But we are quite right to be worried about ISIS. Although today, I would think that Al-Qaeda is more dangerous to the homeland than ISIS, because Al-Qaeda has branches all over where ISIS is more local. So is this the way to go about dealing with ISIS? We have to be very careful in this, because America cannot fight ISIS alone, and we understand that. So we are building anti-ISIS coalitions. Look at the active members: America, Britain, France, Australia, Canada, Italy, Poland, Denmark, Belgium, Germany. None of them from the Middle East. Okay. Then we have some local attempts to get local allies. Turkey is kind of tentative, says we'll help, but maybe not. Okay. Arabs are rather cautious about this, except one group, which is the Saudi group. Saudi and their cohorts, the Emirates, United Arab Emirates, Bahrain, Qatar, and Jordan, okay, who said that they will support us. And in fact, in our flying missions, they fly a few token F-16s, which we have given them. Whether they'll put boots on the ground, we don't know. All our allies say that they will not fight in Syria. They'll fight only in Iraq. Okay. But our unofficial allies, Iran, Al-Qaeda, Hezbollah, Shia militias, are fighting all over the place. Okay. Can we destroy ISIS from the air? Well, we tried that in North Vietnam. We bombed and bombed. I think it'll be necessary to put boots on the ground. But unless we get Arab boots, it will be very dangerous, because if we put our boots on the ground, this will be presented as a Western crusade against all Islam. I see several problems in our situation with ISIS and our approach. Number one, we are bombing Sunnis who support ISIS in Iraq and Syria. Sunnis account for about 80% of all Islamics, and some of them are going to be very upset and even support ISIS. Second, by taking action against ISIS and Assad, we are strengthening our adversaries, Iran. If we knock out ISIS, we'll strengthen Assad. Okay. Bombing of this quantity is sure to create lots of loss of lives. And we have not defined this. We have not said it's a war against ISIS or it's a war against jihadism all over. We have broadened it by bombing some other jihadist groups in Syria. Are we at war with all jihadism? Our government says it will take years to do. Can we sustain this? Today, as of now, our operations are costing $10 million a day. We are in the process of giving another $500 million to the Syrian opposition. Okay. Mm. When you give weapons to good guys in the Middle East, they inevitably end up in the hands of bad guys. Okay. Armed Syrian groups are not very reliable. And then we have another issue. Iran is on the same side as us. How will this affect our nuclear talks with Iran? In short, America is getting into a murky civil and religious war with unreliable allies, new enemies who can emerge anytime, and endless costs. Now, our allies are royalist allies, many of them, Saudis and the Gulf states. If there is an uprising against them in their countries, do we defend them too? ISIS has taken advantage of the confusion in Iraq, and they've been training that. We have spent $1 trillion in Iraq, trained an Iraqi army of 300,000, whose fastest move was running away when they're confronted by ISIS, okay? And ISIS then is fighting with American weapons. Okay. Are there any positives to what we are doing? Yes, we should be doing something. We should be selectively bombing ISIS in response to what they've done to us. But if we turn this into a larger war, it will be endlessly expensive in money and in lives. In short, I think America is embarking on a very serious move to which we have to be very careful. Now, this is not a very popular view, but this is my feeling based on our military experiences from Vietnam to Afghanistan. The Middle East is falling apart. A new map is being drawn. Is ISIS part of that? Maybe. I think we will see in the next few years a breakup of Iraq and Syria is already broken. We'll see the emergence of a Kurdish state in Iraq and parts of Syria. We'll probably see the emergence of a Palestinian state and the breakup of Lebanon. We may see the division of Jordan. Do we want to get involved in all this? What are the prospects for ISIS? I think they're not very good. ISIS is fighting everybody now. They're fighting governments, they're fighting other jihadists, they're fighting Kurds, they're fighting Shias, they're fighting some Sunnis, they're fighting Hamas, they're fighting physically, and ideologically many Islamic groups are against them. But they are a dangerous, well-organized group. Okay. A little sidebar. In the meanwhile, what about Iran, okay, which is going through its own transition between theocrats and reformers? Well, Iran is our ally, and on the nuclear issue, we've been talking and talking and talking to them. We put another deadline, November 24th. What if we fail to get an agreement? What if the only agreement we can get is a weak agreement because they're helping us with ISIS, okay? This is another unresolved question. Iran is part of a larger question, global nuclear non-proliferation. 9 countries today make and have nuclear weapons. They include Pakistan and North Korea. If North Korea can make nuclear weapons, almost anyone can. Okay. We should be getting other nations in another coalition against nuclear proliferation. But that means we'll have to mend our relations with Russia, and that's another issue. Okay. Now, that is our concern with jihadism. How far and how much can we fight jihadism? We have to secure our homeland, first of all. Our second concern in the Middle East, of course, is the security of Israel. This is a very good time of the year, with the dawn of the year 57-75, to reflect on one historical fact. The past 6 decades or so have been the most momentous in Jewish history since the destruction of the Second Temple in 70 BC. The most past few decades have been the most notable in Jewish history in 2,000 years. 2 enormous interrelated events have happened. First, the annihilation of European Jewry, the Holocaust, and the huge and sadly partially successful effort to eliminate Jews from the face of the earth. And second, the creation of the State of Israel. No period of Jewish history in the past 2,000 years has been so consequential. And the net result is the quest for security is lodged in the land. I've seen this firsthand, and this is what I say about Israel today. Israel is stronger than ever before, and Israel's prospects have never been better. Why? Its technology is world-class in every field, and the best exhibition of it is Iron Dome, a huge and startling success. You have a warning of incoming missiles, and then suddenly you hear whoosh, and something goes off and hits the missile above you. Okay. Iron Dome has succeeded. It's a miraculous thing. It's a bullet to hit a bullet that's coming in, and it's working extremely well. Okay. That's one part of technology. Other countries are now chasing after Israel to get that technology. Okay. Its prospects with oil and natural gas are improving, and soon Israel will be a significant energy producer. Okay. Its export economy is extraordinary. 40% of its GDP, national income, comes from exports. A higher percentage than almost any non-petroleum company. And the attempts to boycott haven't succeeded very much. It has a superbly educated labor force. And in today's world, an educated labor force is a tremendous asset. Recently, its foreign relations have been significantly improved. It's quite remarkable that in this recent incursion into Gaza, there was hardly any adverse comment from Arab states. Egypt was quiet. Saudis didn't say very much. Others didn't do very much. Okay. Some kind of quiet, unofficial alliance is emerging between Israel and Sunni states. It's a very strange thing, but it's beginning to emerge. Israel has very good relations with Russia, India, and China. Okay. Now, these are tremendous assets. There are three issues that darken the picture. Number one is not unusual in many countries today. Social issues, housing prices in Israel, social programs for minorities, child welfare, poorer segments of society. These cause occasional protest movements, but that's true in many parts of the world, and it can be adjusted with government policy. The second is, of course, the position of the Orthodox, that 10-15% of the Israeli population who get so many benefits and special exemptions and are supporting right-wing groups. They are, of course, now very controversial, and their efforts to cut down on the benefits they get, including exemption for Orthodox youth in the military. Military service for Orthodox young people has been avoided until now. But some of the military personnel whom I spoke with are as worried about taking the Orthodox into the army, because the arrival of thousands of Orthodox young kids will require separate camps, no contact with women. 1/3 of the Israeli Defense Force is women, and 50% of the officers are women. There'll be a need for special synagogues, ritual baths, special food, and they'll have their own rabbis who may be able to give orders that countermand military officers' orders. So it's a big issue how to incorporate them into the military. On the other hand, these are privileges that most of Israel feels should be removed from them. And they will be eventually. The real big cloud that Israel faces is the Palestinian issue. If that can be worked out, it is of huge benefit to Israel and for the Middle East as a whole. But it cannot be worked out by expanding settlements on the West Bank. Unless this one issue is resolved, Israel will have trouble for years to come. Can it be worked out? Well, America has tried and failed. Almost everybody has tried and failed. And one thing is very clear. You cannot get an agreement by trying to bully or strong-arm Israel. Okay. Relations with the Palestinians have two dimensions. The first is with the West Bank. And that's where all the talks go on. Okay. The West Bank leadership is led by a man called Abbas. He's now about 80 years old. He's a much better man than Arafat. Generally, he has kept the West Bank fairly quiet. together with the barrier that Israel is building. From 2002, Israel has been building a barrier. It will eventually be 500 miles in length. It's now 60% completed. Parts of it are 25 feet high concrete slabs. Others are barbed wire. And it will reduce the contact between the West Bank and Israel. The problem is it cuts through many Palestinian homes. But Abbas has kept this quiet. Abbas has a peculiar relationship with Israel. He interacts very well with some Israeli leaders, but he comes to the UN and condemns Israel vociferously. Okay. Talks with Abbas have gone on and on, not gone very far. The big issue, of course, is settlements. But Abbas is getting older. His political position is getting weaker. Palestinians are saying to him, you are talking and talking with no results. Okay. Time is short, and it would be good to get some agreement with Abbas before he goes. Now, Abbas thinks he can put pressure on Israel by slamming Israel at the United Nations, as he did a couple of days ago. But then he goes and talks again. Okay. How long will this strategy work? Okay. So far, talks have failed. Can they succeed? I don't know. But I think now it is up to Israel to do it itself. That is to say, outsiders have tried. Everyone has tried. I think at some point, Israel will have to say, this is the deal. This is what we're going to do. We'll work it out fairly. And if you agree, okay. If you don't agree, doesn't matter. We will enforce it. Okay. I think this will take some time to do. But the longer it's postponed, the more complex these issues get. And the fact is this, I think any agreement, even not the best agreement, is better than military action and no agreement. Israel is strong enough now to unilaterally impose an agreement, but the problem is political commitment. And there is not much political support for this type of activity. So the West Bank goes on like that. The second part of the Palestinian equation is, of course, Gaza, a very small piece of territory, about five times the size of Manhattan, with a population of close to 2 million, of whom about 60% are below 25 years of age. Okay. Now, Gaza was held by Israel from 1967 to 2005. Then Israel gave it back. Palestinian West Bank Palestinians took it over. In 2007, Hamas pushed them out and took control. Israel immediately blockaded Gaza. And since then, a ritual has gone on. Regularly, Hamas fires rockets at southern Israel. Israel goes in and beats them up. There is a truce for a time. There have been 8 ceasefires so far. It starts again. Okay. Israel goes in, beats them up. There is a ceasefire. And again, the same cycle starts. But this time, it's a little different. Okay. Whenever Israel goes in and destroys parts of Gaza, Israel helps to rebuild Gaza. Okay. It's a very paradoxical thing, okay, in the international community and Israel. Now, it's a little different for 2 reasons. The first is, more long-range rockets were fired by Hamas than ever before. Some of those Hamas rockets can reach Tel Aviv. Now, that is where Iron Dome has worked very well. But it suggests that Hamas is technologically becoming more advanced. Israel has a very interesting strategy with Iron Dome. The cost of each Iron Dome shot is very expensive, a couple of $100,000, okay, maybe more. So Israel can monitor the missiles that are coming in. If they're landing in empty places, which are not very important, Israel lets it land. If it comes towards a population area, Israel unleashes Iron Dome. And that has worked. Okay? But the fact is that Hamas has developed longer range missiles. Now, Hamas has had 10,000 of these. They fired about 4,000. Israel went in and destroyed about 3,000, 4,000. They still have about 2,000 to 3,000 which have not been fired as yet. Okay. So it's a little different in that sense. Second, this was the first tunnel war. That is to say, these tunnels have been built underneath the border between Israel and Gaza, many of them secretly. They're extraordinary things. The Hamas has built an underground Gaza. Okay. In total, the total length, if you put them all together, these 32 that were discovered, it's about 35 miles of tunneling. Okay. They are very well protected, marvelous construction, strong passages, and big money has gone in to do that. Hundreds of millions of dollars have gone into building tunnels instead of developing Gaza. Okay. Well, Israel went in. It's taken out most of the tunnels. There may be a few that are not discovered, but it has managed to control most of the missiles, but it couldn't destroy Hamas. There is a feeling that Israel did not want to totally destroy Hamas because you don't know who will succeed Hamas. Okay. But now there's a ceasefire and some talks going on in Cairo, and Hamas wants the blockade eased and more fishing rights, and Israel wants the end of rockets and tunnels and so on. In the meanwhile, Abbas on the West Bank is trying to get control of Gaza. Gazans were very much against him, as you know, made some agreement but hasn't gone far. And now he's trying to get political control of Gaza. And Egypt, Israel, Saudis, and ourselves are helping him. Why? Because he's better than the jihadists. He is against rocketry. If he gets control of Gaza and has control of the West Bank, then we might be able to work out an agreement that's applicable to both. However, the war has made Hamas popular in the West Bank. And so this process is going on, talks about a ceasefire and an effort to try and take the governance of Gaza away from Hamas. May succeed, may not, but that's what's going on now. After Gaza, what is the mood of Israel? During the Gaza, 54 days in Gaza, everyone supported the government. Even political opponents supported the government. Even peace movements supported the government. Netanyahu's ratings went very high, and Israel moved to the political right. After the ceasefire, the public mood is rather uneasy and shifting. Generally, many Israelis now feel that the time has come to settle this. Netanyahu's ratings have fallen badly. Some think he was not tough enough, some think he's too tough. Okay. And the general Israeli mood is, we can't go on every couple of years going into Gaza and beating them up. Okay. So there will be some support for some genuine talks with Abbas. Now, Abbas himself is aging. He's not very well. And there's another issue. Abbas had an election after Arafat died in 2006, but there have been no other elections on the West Bank. So he's governing as a kind of dictator. We talk about democracy. If we push elections, we may get Hamas on the West Bank. Okay? So we are rather quiet about that. But at some time when we talk about democracy and support for it in the Middle East, we must remember this. Okay? Can some kind of agreement be worked out? It will require some adjustment on the settlements. It will require some exchange of land. Okay? And I think it could be possible, but I don't think Netanyahu will go for it. But then elections are likely to come in Israel. In January 2013, the last elections for the 19th Knesset took place in Israel. A coalition of six parties has been running the country since then. But the divisions in the coalition are very great. The cabinet is fighting with itself. Okay. Netanyahu is having difficulty controlling some of his own people. He had to fire somebody in the cabinet, some segment of his party is trying to break away and form another group. And it's quite possible that elections will come early next year, or at least before the middle of next year. Will Netanyahu win? Okay. We don't know. See, Netanyahu is not a much trusted leader, but he's an extremely clever leader. His political management is masterly. Puts together coalitions, he outwits others. So in a way, the next election will be a test of Netanyahu's skill versus public feeling that perhaps he's going too far. Okay. Something else too is happening. With ISIS having emerged and America getting involved in another conflict, the Iranian issue is less on the front burner in Israel than it has been before. A little sidebar. In Israel, a lot of new political figures and political parties are rising. In the last election, you saw two new figures, Yair Lapid and Naftali Bennett arising, new parties, significant impact on the political system. They both joined Netanyahu in his cabinet, but now they're somewhat disaffected. But there are other new parties in formation. I met some of these younger Israeli politicians, and I draw your attention to new women participants, two in particular, who seem to me promising prime ministerial material. One is the youngest member of the Knesset. Her name is Tav Shafir, 29 years old. She was a leader in the social protest in 2011, extremely able and articulate, a new entrant into Israeli politics. The other is even more curious. It is a young lady called Penina Tamanyu Shatna, who's 33 years old. She's an Ethiopian, the first Ethiopian in the Knesset. There are about 100,000 Ethiopians who were airlifted into Israel 30 years ago. And she's making a very big impact. Okay? Some people even think of her as a future prime minister. Imagine Israel having an Ethiopian Jew as a prime minister. Well, not very far distant, because this year, Miss Israel was an Ethiopian Jew. Okay. So, great possibilities. Okay. But elections will come, these people will make an impact. Very few people realize that in the Knesset of 120 members, there are 11 Arab-Palestinian representatives too, from three Palestinian parties, citizens of Israel. They account for about 10% of the Knesset. And Israel has not capitalized on this or made an issue of this. It should be told to the world. Okay? Now, the picture I've given you is incredibly complex. Middle East is full of these new forces. Okay? Two nations particularly close to us, America and Israel, are deeply entangled in this. The outcome, we cannot say exactly what it is, but we will have a different Middle East from what we have known in another decade. In such situations, it's essential for big powers to be very prudent. I began by saying that in snake pits, outsiders should not go. The Middle East is a work in progress. Keeps people like me busy in business. Okay. What we see is a story that hasn't yet ended, but is well on the way to creating something different from what we're used to. In that complex, Israel today is more secure than it has been, but has to work for its own place too. All this is kind of work in progress. Okay? Therefore, it's very difficult to answer questions about the Middle East. So perhaps we should begin not by trying to answer questions, but trying to question our own answers. Questioning our old answers is what I have tried to do today. Thank you. All right, we have time for questions. Yes, sir.
On all of the talk shows today, they say that America
question is this. Television talk shows have been saying we can't defeat ISIS from the air, have to put boots on the ground. How can we do that? Don't ask me. That's what I've been saying this whole evening, that it's a dangerous thing. It'll be very good if we can get Arab boots on the ground. That is the big question, okay? Yeah, yeah. Well, that's the question, okay? Yeah. Yes. I'm not. Okay. Question is this. If I was in a position to give advice to our government, what would I suggest to ease the present situation or future? I would say stay out as far as possible, subject to jihadism in this country and security of Israel. We now have, on the brink of energy independence, you know, we will be the first industrial country today to be energy independent in a few years. That's a tremendous achievement. It liberates us, okay? I would say that if Americans are victimized, we should punish those who victimize them very severely, but not get involved in any protracted situation. There's another aspect to it. Are we financially able to support another long war with our condition today, okay? So I would say prudent disengagement subject to Israel and export of jihadism. Okay. Yeah. Yes?
Why do you think the jihadis would be worse than Hamas?
Why do I think?
Why do you think the jihadis would be a worse scenario than Hamas is right now?
Why would the jihadis be a worse than Hamas? Not much worse. Okay.
Why isn't Israel taking out Hamas then?
No, because Israel deals with the West Bank very carefully. They are worried, for one thing, that if Hamas totally goes, worse forces might arise there. Okay, Islamic Jihad is there, various other groups, okay, one thing. Second thing is that if there is some agreement that they can make with Abbas, they will have to extend it to Gaza. And in that process, maybe, just maybe, you might be able to get some support from some sections of Hamas. Okay? So that is the reason why they don't do that. Many in Israel say you should wipe them out completely. Okay? But that's going to be very difficult to do because they are interwoven in the population and they don't hesitate to interweave themselves even further. Okay? So Israel is very careful in doing that. That's the reason for this. Yes? We speak about the political relationship between Saudis, Emirates, and Israel. Are there economic relationships which are going on? Yes, but not much discussed, okay? I was once in a hotel, yeah, and I saw a number of people who looked sort of Middle Eastern Orient. I asked them, where are you from? So they said, they're from Indonesia. So I said, oh, good, I want to discuss Indonesia with you. What's happening there? They didn't know a thing. They were Arabs pretending to be Indonesians, okay? So there are various unofficial things going on, okay? It'll be much better if it can be done openly, okay? But those are going on. Technology exchanges. One of the things that Arab states are enormously interested in Israel is, of course, desalination, where Israel is a world leader. Iron Dome draws attention from around the world. So in answer to your question, yes, it could be much more, it could be much bigger if it's done more openly, but yes, it's going on, okay? Yeah. Yes?
Professor, I have a question. I'm a little bit confused. You mentioned
No. Yeah, large numbers of groups, they're saying that they're coming over here. We have to, if they come, we have to do something about it, but just responding to empty threats, we shouldn't do that. If America is affected, we should beat them up very badly, but not get involved in a protracted long war. That's my point, okay? Because protracted long wars are not going to work out in our favor, okay? Periodic attacks, if something happens, yes. I think they should be punished for what they've done to Americans, as I said. But to get into a long war, we've got into so many long wars without many results, okay? They are one of the worst groups. Then ISIS will come and ISIS will go. Other ISISs will arise. Are we to fight every ISIS in the world? That's another big question that we will have to face in the future, okay? Perhaps once upon a time, we could have done something like that. Today, we are not in a condition financially to do that kind of thing. That's the complexity of this. Okay.
2 years ago, 2 years ago, they said if President Obama would have intervened 2 years ago, ISIS wouldn't exist.
If President Obama did what?
If he would have intervened in Syria 2 years ago.
You know, if President Obama would have intervened in Syria, ISIS wouldn't exist. That's nonsense, because ISIS is an Iraqi organization. They started in Iraq, they developed in Iraq. From there, they got into Syria, okay? People say if he intervened in Syria, but you know. And of course, you know, second guessing is very easy because if Osama bin Laden wasn't born.
Did you support the initial bombing by the United States in Iraq when ISIS moved against the minorities that went into the mountains?
Yes. There are some group there called Yazidis who were on the brink of being eliminated. The Iraqis should have saved them, but they were not prepared to do this, so we had to provide some relief, and we did. It's good. Yeah. Yes. A little louder, please. Your point is this: if these have oil, people have oil money, why are we giving weapons to them? And I think we are in need of foreign aid, not others, but anyway. Why are we giving weapons to them? I can't agree with you more. I think we should have learned from Afghanistan that when you give weapons to people, you don't know where they go in the end. And once again, we are falling into that same pattern. You're absolutely correct. I wish you were our Secretary of State. In fact, one of these days, our Secretary of State will wish you were his Secretary of State because he's getting worn out. Okay. Yeah. Yes.
Who are the Syrian rebels?
About 75 different groups, all sorts of people, some who don't like Assad for political reasons, some who are disaffected from his military, some who are jihadists, some who are super jihadists, some who are minorities, like trying to break away some tribal groups and so on. Assad belongs to a group called the Alawis. About 15% of the population support him. It's a fight to the death for them. And they are closer to the Shias. Sunnis don't much like him, so they're Sunni groups. Some of these groups are off the wall. We have a few groups that we think like this. Syrian army means opponent army, opposition army. But nothing very much. The strongest, in fact, are the jihadists, because they are the best organized, okay, against Assad. Assad is putting up one hell of a fight, okay? And he's doing that because it's life or death, and also Russia is helping him. Okay? Now, these various groups shift from one side to another side. They join each other, they fight with each other, okay? And among the strongest of them is ISIS and another group called Nusra, which is Al-Qaeda's group, okay? Now, Iran supports Assad and has men fighting for Assad. Okay, Hezbollah has men fighting for Assad. Okay, so there are all sorts of groups in this. Some of those groups in the opposition to Assad are attracting young people from all over the world. That's what disturbs me. 2,000 people from Europe joining these various groups. 200 Americans have joined some of these Europeans there. Okay, the blowback possibilities are what are dangerous, and that is why I say we should protect this, our state more than anything, because who knows what will happen when they come back. We have, so far, fairly good tabs on these people. We are watching them. But you know, with an American passport, you can move around the world. Okay? So that is. Assad opponents now control about 40% of the country, but divided among all of them. Okay? ISIS is the largest section. Assad controls about 35%. There's no man's land. Okay? In all of this, the Kurds, who are in Syria in a small number, in Iraq in a bigger number, okay, and in Turkey in a very big number, have seen an opportunity to try and develop their great dream of a state. Israel supports them. Okay, they've been quite close to Israel, particularly the Iraqi Kurds. Now, this is another problem, because we want Turkey to join us. We are already helping the Kurds. Turkey fears that the weapons we give to the Kurds will be used in a civil war in Turkey. Okay? So there are all sorts of complexities in this. Okay? It is truly a snake pit. Okay? Yes, sir.
Do you know about why the Iraqi army folded up as fast as they did? Do you have any insights as to whether the American military really knew that they were corrupt and not going to be any good, or did they cover it all up?
If the American military didn't know that they were corrupt, the American military has lost its eyesight. The Iraqi army, which we have trained for so many years, is 300,000 troops. There are also about, nobody knows the exact number, thousands of phantom troops. Phantom troops are people who are registered and the officers take the money, and there are no such people, but they're put in there for financial purposes, okay? The army is largely Shia. They beat up the Sunnis, okay? They exploit what they can. And we, in leaving Iraq, were assured by many of our military leaders that we have trained these people, don't worry about it, okay? Why did they collapse? Either they were frightened or they... If you were asked to give your life for Malaki as your leader to fight somebody, would you do that, okay? Something like fighting for Karzai in Afghanistan, all right? Now we are hoping that we'll get a new government that can organize this together. In the meanwhile, there are religious groups, Shia militias, who are saying, we will fight it if the army cannot, okay? And that's another issue. So the collapse of the army is no tribute to our training capabilities. Okay. Yes, sir. How long can the Jordanian government survive? It's a very good question, because this is a weak government. Okay. And there are certain difficulties in Jordan. Jordan is a small country with 6-7 million people. The majority of the people are Palestinians. About 55-60%. About 40% are Bedouins, Arab of another tribe. The king is a Bedouin. Okay. His father, King Hussein, was extremely skillful in balancing both parts of the Jordanian population. His son is not quite so smart as the father in doing that. Okay. There's some trouble between him and the Bedouin tribes, which there shouldn't be, because they're his bedrock of support. Palestinians will be waiting to attach that part of Jordan to the Palestinian territories. Okay, he survives largely because of American and Israeli support. Okay? And he's trying very hard, but it's a rather weak state. Now, he's having even more trouble because tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands, of Syrians have come across the border as refugees. Okay, so there's also some irritation by some people in Jordan at the Queen's behavior. Okay. People should learn from Mrs. Marcos. Okay. All right. Yes. Of course they are. Are Saudis afraid of these jihadists? Are they not a kind of jihadist themselves? Yes, in a way, but they are very afraid because many of these jihadists say that the Saudi royal family has no right to rule that area. And there's a big prize, the holy sites of Islam. This royal family controls it now. The title of the king is guardian of the holy places of Islam. Any Islamic group that gets control of that automatically has a big status in the world of Islam. Yeah. I do not think that a system based on hereditary royalty with certain social restrictions can last for a long time. Okay. I mean, you know, my own feeling is from next week to 10 years from now, there's a possibility of a major uprising in Saudi Arabia. Okay. Then comes the question, do we go to defend them? Where will want us to defend them? Or do we say, no, we'll do a Mubarak, go away? And who gets the oil fields? That's another issue. Despite our urging and other urging, the Saudis have not been reforming as they should. Okay. So that is a concern. Now, of course, we have to count on them as helping us. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. And it's necessary. We must have some Arab support of some kind. Yes, sir. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, ma'am. I see a lady with her hand up.
Do you think that Iran will get the atom bomb? And if so, what do you predict will happen?
Will Iran get a nuclear weapon? My off-the-head guess is no, for this reason. Not that they may not want it, not that they will be working on the technology. But you and I have little idea of the huge clandestine program that is being aimed at Iran's technology. Sometimes it's a Stuxnet that sets them back. Sometimes some scientists disappear. Sometimes there are mysterious fires in some laboratories. I think that apart from direct action, we have such a big program that this will lead them to stumble along the way. That's my feeling. Now, that may be wrong, but that's my second, I think they themselves are now very worried about the economic sanctions that have been imposed on them. That's why they're talking. Okay? And I think there's a group in Iran, the reformers, who do not like the theocracy. It's a slow movement away from theocracy, but very slow. So I think that unless there's some amazing development, the chances of their getting a nuclear weapon are somewhat distant. Okay. Yes, yes.
You mentioned that women are losers.
Arab Spring, yeah. Women are the losers. Is there any specific information on their feelings and so on? There's a lot of work that has been done on this, but the fact is it's not easy to do it in countries like Egypt today, okay, because the government has become so tight. However, we know that many women are very unhappy at the fact that they tried to contribute to political action. Now they're pushed back into the background. I think that these women will eventually join other young people and begin another movement in time. Although the military in Egypt has been very brutal, they've killed several thousand people because they were associated with a Muslim Brotherhood and so on. I think there's a latent wave, and I think women are part of that. I can't give you precise data on that, but from what I have heard and from what I've seen people, the women are... Now, of course, among women, you'll also find some jihadists. Don't ask me why, but you'll find that. Okay? But I think that younger women, particularly, are feeling this problem. Look at the Arab Spring, at the crowds, a sizable portion were younger women. Okay? So that was something we'd never seen before. Mm-hmm. So that's my answer to you. Not a very good answer, but that's the best I can give you. Okay. Yeah. Yes. What is my view of paying ransom? You know, you've got me. I really can't answer that because I have mixed feelings. You're right. I have mixed feelings. Some countries pay, some countries don't pay. Interestingly, many people, including some of our people, you know, they're pirates of Somalia who hijack things. They pay ransom to get their ships free, okay? But further into the Middle East, we have not been paying ransom. Now, Israel does, others do, so it's a matter of government policy, okay? I have very mixed feelings about this, you know. Please don't come to my lectures with these questions like that. I think, have to look at each circumstance differently, okay? Who is holding them? What degree of torture are they being subject to or not? Okay. What is their family situation? All that. Okay. It's very difficult to give you a clear answer. Some states say they don't pay and quietly pay under the table. Okay. Others help families to collect money and pay. Okay. So there are many different answers to this. Many states say we are against it publicly. But quietly, there's some reports that France is one of those states. No, okay. So I really can't give you a clear answer whether you should pay ransom or not. All I know is that some do, and Israel is a very good example. Okay? In fact, there's something else in Israel which is very interesting. There is something called the Hannibal device or Hannibal procedure. Israel doesn't want any of its military held as ransom. Okay. If there is, it's an extreme thing, if a soldier is kidnapped and being taken away and there's no chance of getting him back, under certain circumstances, the Israeli army will kill everybody. Those who are capturing him, including him. Okay. Because ransom is so much. It's called the Hannibal procedure. In certain rare cases, they won't take the risk of having ransom, okay? If they cannot, because these are often these people capture somebody, you can see them from the air, you can monitor them, and so on. The question is, how do you get your soldier released without damaging him? If you can't, maybe instead of his being a hostage against the nation, you should wipe out the whole group.
You said Israel is more secure today, yet Hezbollah has 100,000 rockets.
Yeah.
How much of the United States?
Hezbollah has many rockets on the northern border. You said 100,000. The figure is somewhere. Is that safety? I think that the Israeli capacity, if those rockets begin, to just cross the border and take them out is very large, okay? That they are not fired from a long distance, they are across the line. I think the Israeli military has plans for that. Iron Dome will stop some of those that come to the cities. The others, there will have to be boots on the ground to take it out. Okay? And that is a risky thing. But if George Bush never became president, would we be in this mess? That's also another iffy question, okay? If George Bush wasn't born, he wouldn't become president. All I can say is this. If we had a higher voter turnout, Al Gore would have been president, not Bush. Already there was the hanging chads and so on. And I don't think Al Gore would have got us into this situation. I don't think, okay? I think that my own view is this. I think under normal circumstances, Bush Jr. would have been a sort of average, sort of conservative president, Calvin Coolidge or something like that, okay? Suddenly he was confronted with this situation. My own feeling is that he didn't quite know what to do. But there were others around him who had all the plans ready, Cheney and crowd. Here, this is what you should do. So he said, yes, okay. In fact, there's some people who suggest that now he's sorry about all this, okay? Certainly his relations with Cheney apparently are not very good now because of this, okay? So, but who knows if he was somebody else was president, what would have happened, okay? Yes. If the what?
Why is that?
Why is religious extremism, why has it become worse in the past few decades? I think there's many answers to that. It has become worse all over the world. Here, in other places, Hindu nationalism in India, okay, Buddhist nationalism in Burma, and in the Middle East. In the Middle East, you can almost directly trace it to the Ayatollah's activism. When he took over Iran in 1979, he immediately began a program of energizing Shias around the area. And that has had a very big impact. Shias were always sort of secondary to the Sunni numbers. Okay? He gave a certain focus to this, and that has continued the momentum. It has become now a Shia redemptionist movement. Okay? But you know, it's something that's very interesting. In the modern world, in a secular world, why has religious, let us say, jihadism in many different religions, begun to express itself at this stage in human society? In Israel, here, okay, in Asia, the only part that hasn't had a lot of local jihadism is Western Europe. But then there are immigrants from the Middle East who supply that element in Europe. Okay? I'm not sure why this time in history is it that many people are feeling alienated, that modernization has left them out, that there's nothing they can reach out to except some religious answer which simplifies things for them. Okay? In a way, the Tea Party is a byproduct of that. Okay, so. Okay, thank you very much for joining me. I hope to see you again.